In general, Nakamoto consensus delivers a few key properties. First off, this paradigm serves as a way to come to consensus with unknown, untrusted peers. In Bitcoin, the first distributed system to use Nakamoto consensus, hence the name Nakamoto consensus, anyone can join or leave the network at any time and even send corrupted messages or false messages to others. Additionally, any user can have as many virtual identities or public-private key pairs as they want. To prevent unfair voting from anyone who dishonestly creates multiple identities, voting power must be made scarce, done by tying voting power to a scarce resource. Bitcoin just happened to use computational power as the scarce resource, but that is just one of many possible resources to expend to achieve Nakamoto consensus. Because of this implicit manner of voting, leaders are elected through a random lottery, where the likelihood of winning this lottery increases with the expended resources, pay-to-play style. The winner of the lottery is then allowed to create the next update in the system. In blockchain networks, the block represents that very update. When the vote is cast, it's possible that the lottery chose a malicious leader. In this case, others in the network vote implicitly on the proposed update by either including the update in their own local view of the system state or by refusing to accept it. For example, in Bitcoin, full nodes can choose which blocks they include in their blockchain, but their chain will only be valid if the rest of the network is in consensus. Hence, each Nakamoto consensus protocol must have a set of rules defining how to choose the most valid state of the network, such as the longest chain policy in Bitcoin, one example of a fork resolution policy. For this reason, some choose to refer to Nakamoto consensus as chain-based consensus. We'll understand this better in a bit when we look at chain and BFT-based proof-of-stake implementations. In the next couple slides, we'll be taking a look at various consensus mechanisms that fall under the wide umbrella of Nakamoto consensus. And for each, we'll be focusing on what resources each consumes and how the network uses that resource to come to consensus. First, just as a recap and to understand Nakamoto consensus in something that we already know, take Bitcoin. In Bitcoin, miners solve partial pre-image hash puzzles so as to prevent naive Sybil attacks and to tie voting power to a scarce physical resource. The image on the right-hand side is from our first course, Bitcoin and Cryptocurrencies, and shows exactly that. The miner who solves the block first gets to send it to the rest of the network. The rest of the network then implicitly votes on that block, since they have the power to choose to append it to their local copies of the blockchain. In proof of work, the resource consumed is computational power. The faster a miner can compute hashes, the more likely they're able to find the next valid block and send it to the rest of the network. The next example of Nakamoto consensus is proof of stake. This one's a bit tricky since there are very many different implementations of proof of stake, but in general, some of them can be classified as Nakamoto consensus mechanisms as well. Like the miners in proof of work, validators in proof of stake are tasked with creating updates and supporting the network. Instead of expending computational power, proof of stake instead uses its native currency. As in, the more native currency a validator stakes, the more likely they're going to be elected to propose or create the next update. There's a lot to talk about when it comes to proof of stake, so we'll be going into that in the next section, after the following comparisons with other Nakamoto consensus mechanisms. Proof of activity is a hybrid consensus mechanism that borrows from both proof of work and proof of stake. The general algorithm is as follows. First, miners solve and submit blocks to the system in the standard proof-of-work fashion. Then, the system switches to proof-of-stake. The block header contains data that represents a random group of validators who are required to sign the new block. And like in proof-of-stake, the more coins a validator has staked, the more likely they are to be chosen to sign off on the block. The block fees and rewards are split among the miners and various validators. Once the validators have signed the newly found block, the block is complete and users are free to add it to their copies of the blockchain. So in proof of activity, the resources consumed are both proof of work and proof of stake resources. Miners consume computational power, and validators consume the native currency. Next up is proof of burn. It's like proof of stake, but edgier. This one's a bit tricky, since the term proof of burn can be used to refer to a number of things. For example, in Bitcoin, you can prove the existence of arbitrary data by sending a transaction to an irretrievable address, thereby writing your data into the blockchain and paying the transaction fees to no one, burning your coin. But that is not what we are talking about here. Proof of burn, in this context, refers to a Nakamoto consensus mechanism In proof of burn, the more coins you send to an irretrievable address, or the more coins you burn, the higher the likelihood is of you being elected and being able to create the next block. Proof of burn is like proof of stake, except that once you stake your coin, you can't get it back. Hence, the edgier part. You're destroying coins in order to stake. As a side note, burning coins can also be used as a bootstrapping mechanism for new systems. You could tie a new coin's value to some other existing coin. For example, a new cryptocurrency could derive its value from the burning of Bitcoin. In summary, the resource consumed in proof of burn is currency, and that could either be native currency or potentially some other non-native currency. Another novel category of Nakamoto consensus is proof of space. Proof of space consumes storage space as a limiting resource for voting power. Proof of space is seen by some to be more fair and energy efficient than other consensus mechanisms, such as proof of work, due to the availability of storage as well as its lower energy cost. Nowadays, proof of space is used primarily for file storage rather than as an implicit voting mechanism, though the implementations vary. For example, there are also other protocols that give rewards directly for storing information, such as Filecoin, Storage, and SIA. On the other hand, proof of capacity is a type of proof of space that is very similar to the other Nakamoto consensus mechanisms we've been talking about previously. Instead of proving you've done work or staked some coin, you show that you solved some problem involving a non-trivial amount of storage capacity. Then you can propose the next block or update to the system and receive coins for your computation. In a sense, proof of capacity can be seen as a memory-hard proof-of-work protocol. At their core, though, all systems use some sort of proof of space in order to limit users' influence on the system. There's also proof of elapsed time, which has users consume time. The way they do this is by first picking a random duration of time to wait, and then waiting for that duration of time. In order to enable this sort of behavior, we need to trust that the users are actually waiting for however long they say they're waiting, and that it's truly random. This is where trusted execution environments come in, particularly Intel SGXs. Trusted execution environments are separate environments from your computer's main memory that can only be accessed with certain CPU instructions. This prevents tampering by other external processes. Think processes that govern fingerprint sensors on mobile devices or alternative payment options. The way it works is that we simply ask users to wait a random time, and once that random time is up, then they get to propose the next update. The two assumptions to satisfy here are one, that the time chosen to wait is actually random, and two, that we have actually waited that long. And this is functionality that is built into trusted execution environments. Once code is loaded into the trusted execution environment, it generates an attestation or proof that the environment is working as intended and that the right code is running the right way. Users can't interfere with the trusted execution environment since the memory space that it runs on is private and any sort of tampering would result in a faulty attestation. However, this is all based on your trust in the manufacturer of the trusted execution environments. So if you're trusting Intel SGX, you have to trust Intel and their entire production process that they haven't accidentally or maliciously introduced a backdoor or vulnerability. A mechanism that does not directly fall under the category of Nakamoto consensus, but that is worth mentioning, is proof of authority. Proof of authority relies on trusted individuals signing off on updates to the network, and is primarily used in permissioned or non-production networks. For example, the Coven and Rinkeby Ethereum test networks use CLIC, a proof of authority implementation. Following some attacks on Ropsten, proof of authority was chosen as a way to better control vulnerable, valuable, but not publicly controlled testnets. The resource consumed here is identity. There's a question mark because this follows the paradigm of politically centralized systems with a few actors making decisions for the rest of the network.